Introduction of Predecessors of Cleopatra. Predecessors of Cleopatra by Leigh North. Introduction. In attempting even a brief and imperfect outline of the history of Egyptian queens, the author has undertaken no easy task and craves indulgence for its modest fulfillment. The aim has been merely to put the little that is known in a readable and popular form, to gather from many sources the fragments that remain, partly historic, partly legendary, of a dead past, to present, however imperfectly, sketches of the women who once lived and breathed as queens of Egypt, which has been more ably and completely done as the period was less remote and the sources of information fuller for their royal sisters of other lands. A short article published some years ago in Lippincott's magazine may be said to be the nucleus of the present volume, the writer's interest in the subject having been awakened by the study necessary to its preparation. We enter a house through the portico or vestibule. We form acquaintances on somewhat the same principle. We begin, perhaps, with the weather. We exchange comments on trifles. We pass through an introductory stage of intercourse before we reach the real heart of the man or woman who, in time, becomes our dearest friend. Skip the introduction, if you will, busy reader, but metaphorically it forms the portico or vestibule of the Egyptian house. From the darkness which envelops the centuries, modern research has brought to light much that was unknown or forgotten. With almost the creative touch, it has made the dry bones to live again and link by link, drawn out the long chain of the years. What was once a mere roll of names with a wide hiatus here and there has grown to be a record of the words and deeds of men of like passions with ourselves. We feel once more in touch with the past, as it is the aim of the highest altruism to beat responsive to the heart of the present, and the bygone faces look forth by the side of modern man and claim the universal brotherhood. Well may we marvel at the faith, the patience, the ingenuity which has unraveled so much of the tangled skein in the story of the nations. Like Cuvier, from a single bone elaborating a whole animal, the Egyptologist has patiently evolved from shreds of parchment, from fragments of pottery, from broken plinth and capital, a more or less complete whole. He has woven a tapestry from which some of the figures start forth with a lifelike vigor. Few countries claim such antiquity as Egypt, and of none were the estimated dates more widely apart, sometimes involving periods of hundreds and thousands of years. An accumulation of difficulties meets the student as it does the explorer. A cycle of time, beside which modern life seems like a single breath, a language at first indecipherable and even now imperfectly read, the hasty guesses of scholars anxious to prove some point or be in the vanguard of discovery, broken monuments, rifled tombs, and inscriptions mutilated, erased, and altered by the monarchs of succeeding generations. Among all these difficulties lies the way, but with patience and care we are rewarded, and with imagination for a servant, not a master, one arrives, as the French say, at least in a measure, at last. The list of authorities consulted by the author would be too long to enumerate, but among them may be mentioned Rawlinson, Wilkinson, Maspero, Ehrman, Ebers, and later Edwards, Sace, Petrie, and Mahaffey, whose interest is so absorbing, and the researches of some of whom are of such recent date. To these may be added the study of all available pictures and photographs, and the experiences of late travel and travelers. End of introduction.
Chapter 1 of Predecessors of Cleopatra. Predecessors of Cleopatra by Leigh North. The Black Land. Kem, the Black Land, in hieroglyphic or Kemi, in the later and more familiar Demotic, was so called from its dark and fruitful soil, a loam, which turned up freshly after a recent inundation of the Nile, has, as one traveller describes it, a brown and velvety lustre. Through it winds and flows the great river of which Homer speaks as Egypt's heaven-descended stream, and that more than any other has set its stamp upon the country and its inhabitants. So potent for weal or woe is it, that one scarce wonders it was worshipped as a deity, and the Arabs call it El Bahari, the sea. It is difficult to find the word travel in their language. With the Egyptian, it is always up and down stream. From the river he drew the fish, which formed part of his daily food, its fructifying waters spreading over the land, called forth abundant harvests, and from the mud on its banks he built the hut in which he lived, or manufactured the bricks for the construction of his tomb or other more ambitious edifice. The rushes that grew beside it furnished his writing material, and its muddy or turbid water, as a beverage, had for him the charm of a crystal rill. Leigh Hunt says of the Nile, "It flows through old hushed Egypt, and its sands, like some grave mighty thought, threading a dream, and times and things as in that vision seem, keeping along it their eternal sands." The Nile has said to be less like a river than a sinuous lake, with islands and sandbars interspersed. The sacred name of the Nile was Hapi, the concealed. The early Egyptians believed that its source was in fountains, bottomless and far away, and the tears of the goddess Isis caused its ebb and flow. The explorations of comparatively modern travellers have solved the mystery of its being, and today we know that it springs from great lakes, which their discoverers named respectively Victoria and Albert Nyanza. Of the three great rivers, the Nile, the Mississippi, and the Amazon, the first is the longest, the second has the largest number of ramifications, and the third the greatest volume of water. A Nilometer, a pillar standing in a pit, chronicles the rise of the tide, and great festivities attended the opening of the canals, which were dug in all directions to carry its beneficent stream. A human victim was sacrificed to appease the river god. A young girl was each year dedicated to this purpose, bound to a stake, adorned with flowers, and hailed as Arusa, the bride of the Nile. She stood and watched the oncoming flood, which was to shut out for her the light of day. Perhaps it was in the terror with which the bounding pulses of youth must ever regard the great destroyer. Perhaps with the heroic spirit of a martyr, she awaited her fate, glorying in it and giving herself up a willing sacrifice, as the Hindu woman is said occasionally to have done in the sati when she cast herself on the funeral pile of her husband. It was a Mohammedan general who put an end to this annual tragedy and refused to permit the usual offering. The river delayed its rising, and the murmurs of the people waxed loud against him. In this dilemma, he appealed to the Caliph Omar, he who destroyed the Alexandria library, saying that if it agreed with the Quran, it was useless to preserve it, and if it differed, it was pernicious. But in this matter, he showed himself larger-minded. He obligingly wrote a letter, which was cast into the water, and ran thus. A.D. 640. From Abdallah Omar, Prince of the Faithful, to the Nile of Egypt. If thou flow from thine own accord, flow not. But if it be Allah, the One, the Mighty, who causeth thee to flow, then we implore him to make thee flow. The prayer was successful, and the inundation began. Henceforth, a mud pillar, originally no doubt in human form, and still called the Bride of the Nile, was substituted for a trembling maiden, and melted away before the encroaching stream. At the inundation, the land looks like a marsh, the towns, etc., being just above the level of the water, and even now the crier announces the rise of the current. The juncture of the white and blue Nile shows the difference in the tint of the water for some time after. The Nile has no tides. The dews are heavy in Lower Egypt, and the nights cool and refreshing, while the temperature is, as a rule, most agreeable. From the low, long, level shore, and with a coastline much the same as 3,000 years ago, we follow the river through a fertile valley, which in time narrows between the mountains and the tablelands of sand. At the cataracts, the stream surges and swells round little rocky islands, and the rapids cause navigation to be difficult, if not dangerous. The delta, so called from its resemblance to the Greek letter, is a level plain, highly cultivated, varied by lofty dark brown ancient mounds, on which villages are often built, surrounded by palm trees. The Greeks and Romans divided Egypt into the Delta, or Lower Egypt, and the Thebaid, or Upper. The rocks are generally of limestone, till one reaches Thebes, and then they are of sandstone, while at the first cataract, red granite bursts through the sandstone. The granite is yellowish or reddish, with no vegetation on the rocks. The drifts of yellow sand are everywhere. In some parts, the mountains are 300 feet high, and at Thebes, they rise to four times that height. On the eastern side, they are close to the water, while on the western, they are further from the edge. What is called the Fayum is a fertile tract in the hollow of the desert, while at the furthest extremity is a lake of brackish water. Upper Egypt is bounded by mountains, through which the river has cut its way, their height overshadowing it, but not rising into sharp peaks. It is narrow and cultivated. From the mouth of the Nile to the first cataract is 600 miles of fertile valley, and it is said that the scenery of the first cataract resembles nothing but that of the second. The beauty of Egypt is in its colouring. The small proportion of green is compensated for by its intensity. Over the velvet soil hangs a sky of turquoise blue. The sand sparkles like precious stones, and the clear air is luminous. The land where it is always afternoon might almost be named the Golden Land. The traveller, with the poetic or enthusiastic temperament, revels in the delicate variety of its hues. He sees the sun turning the sands to gold, the river reflecting the sky, the blue lotus blossoms and the reeds, the picturesque buffaloes standing in the water with sleepy blue eyes, and the vivid green of wheat fields. Another describes the rusty gold of the Libyan rocks, the paler hue of the driven sand slopes, the warm mauve of the nearer pyramid, which from a distance is a tender rose, like the bloom of an apricot, in delicate tone against the sky. Low on the horizon, soft and pearly tints, blue and luminous at the zenith, while opalescent shadows, pale blue and violet and greenish-grey, nestle in the hollows of the rocks and curves of the sand drifts. Lake-like plains with palm groves and corn flats relieve the glowing distance. Even in the moonlight, one seems to see the colour. From the top of the pyramids, the valley of the Nile looks like a carpet of rich green, the groves of palm trees like figures woven in deeper tints. Another speaks of the palms as sculptured in jasper and malachite against the rosy evening sky. A sense of rest and tranquility pervades the mind. Straight in his ears, the gushing of the wave, far, far away, did seem to mourn and rave. Even the conscience slumbers, but the prosaic traveller hurries through all with unseeing eyes, like the tourist who visited Cologne and was too sleepy to get up and look at the cathedral. He gapes at the pyramids, viewing them perhaps as warts on the face of creation, and sees no glory in the heavens, no beauty in the earth. The story of the ages has no charm for him. Long before Once Upon a Time, if such a period can be conceived of, the great monuments were raised, the colossal temples were built, which have been the wonder of all succeeding centuries, and yet still, back of and beyond that, stretching away to the confines of eternity, we picture to ourselves the land as it then was, without those marvels of art, when nature ruled supreme. Then, as now, the plains stretched out, the yellow cliffs rose against the azure sky, the desert spread afar, the purple cloud of the simoon hovered over it. The sun sank in splendour of violet, rose and gold. The torn and ragged sides of the mountain poured down their torrents of shining sand, the fissures burning with a crimson lustre. The splendour passed and ashy paleness followed. Then a second paler but intense yellow hue, ere the stars shone out. And ever the Nile, calm and unruffled, swept on with its eternal flow, while the air breathed balm. Sometimes the waters gained, sometimes the sand. The Byblos or papyrus, now almost extinct, abounded. Along the water's edge, forest and reeds, later destroyed, were plentiful, and wild bear, hippopotami and crocodiles, whose ancient haunts know them no more, roved freely. The lakes abounded with fish. Pelicans and ducks lived on the shores, and the turtle doves brooded on the palm trees. The language of Egypt has been changed once, the religion twice, but the natural conditions remain steadfast. Before Menes, the first king of whom any distinct record has yet been recovered, man, civilized man, possessed the earth. In tracing the course of Egyptian history, we never, as with many other nations, seem to reach primeval humanity. Like Minerva, springing ready armed from the brain of Jupiter, the earliest Egyptian known is in a measure civilized. The wild savage who develops into the more perfect man exists in theory, but we cannot lay our hand upon him. Some authorities, as Professor Petrie, attribute the beginning of Egyptian civilization, as the Greeks found it, to Mesopotamian influences, and think the conquering race came over the Red Sea, and the conquered were of the same general type as the Libyans of North Africa. But none of these stories have yet been proved beyond the possibility of differing opinion by other students. Strabo said, "The Egyptians lived from the first under a regular form of government. They were a people of civilized manners and settled a well-known country." Claiming to be the most ancient of peoples, the old story tells how Egyptians yet yielded their pretensions to the Phrygians. The king caused a shepherd to bring up two children, nursed by a goat, and to observe what word they first spoke. Running towards him, they cried Bekos, the Phrygian for bread, which decided the question, but the wise mother goat perhaps considered they were but imitating her Ba'a. The early Egyptian believed that Osiris and Isis, brother and sister, as also husband and wife, were the children of Seb, Saturn, and Nephthys was the sister of Isis. The two were called the incubators, who spread their wings over the mummy to impart new life. Isis represented as a female figure, wearing on her head the shent, or crown of Upper and Lower Egypt, was the earth, the receptive one, was regarded as the mother of all, and held somewhat the position to the Egyptians that Juno did to the Greeks. The Egyptians also believed that the heavens were upheld by four pillars, and that the stars were lamps lighted therein at night. Osiris and Isis stood for the Nile and Egypt, and Osiris was the sun's power, the winter solstice, the birth of Horus the summer solstice, the inundations of the Nile, the autumnal equinox. His gods and goddesses were innumerable, their images existing for him in the shape of various animals and birds, and among royalties, the ancestors were deified. We of today thrust from us the thought of death, and live as much as may be in the present. Not so the Egyptian. It pervaded his daily life, and it shared in his feasts and festivals. It rang in his laughter. Let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. And his favourite occupation was the building of his tomb. No other nation possesses such a variety of monuments, says one writer. Their stone quarries were inexhaustible, their facilities for transportation on the great river unlimited, and the sand and the climate combined to preserve what the hand of man erected. Kings pressed their signets on the mountains that the generations to come might know of them and their power. The sun and soil of Egypt, we are told, demands one breed of men and will no other. The children of aliens die, and the special race characteristics remain to the present day. The fellah woman, in the picture often seen, crouching beside the statue of an ancient king, has the same contour of face, the same high cheekbones and nose, and the same immutable expression. As the life rule of Egypt's great river changes not, year after year, repeating the same history, so the race shows the same characteristics century after century. She shares with China her changelessness. Like Japan, she has her types of face, long, oval, slender, with heavy-lidded eyes, and nose characteristically depressed at the tip, with sensitive open nostrils, the underlip slightly projecting, the chin short and square, with a slim, square-shouldered figure. Or a lower squatter type, belonging to the plebeian, forehead low, nose depressed and short, face prognathous and sensual-looking, the chin heavy, the jaw large, the lips thick and projecting. Both exist on the earliest monuments and to our own time. One writer thinks that the mummies differ from the Arabs of the present day in having a better balance of the intellectual and moral faculties. It is also said that in men the countenance is narrower than in women, the forehead small and retreating, with a long, large black and well-shaped eye, a long nose with a slight bridge, cheekbones a little prominent, an expressive mouth with full lips, and white regular teeth, and a small round chin. The complexion of men a dark brown, that of women olive to a pink flesh colour. The women and girls are slender, with small straight brows and close lashes on each lid, which gives an animated expression to their almond-shaped eyes. The use of kohl, sometimes said to be sanitary in its effects, enhancing this. The forehead is receding, cheekbones high, the bridge of the nose low, the mouth wide and thick-lipped. The peasantry are darker than the townspeople, and the colour deepens from pale brown to bronze as you go south. Coexistent with, prior even perhaps, to the pyramids, is the Great Sphinx. Maspero believed that it dated before the time of Menes. Battered, mutilated, time-worn, yet rearing itself nobly still, with its majestic face in its tranquil grandeur, turned towards the east. Towering 60 feet above one of the sand dunes, with a background of yellow sand or sapphire sky, or whitening in the moonlight against the starlit indigo heavens, rises this colossal head and shoulders. Mutilated though it is, says one traveller, the changeless serenity, the eternal repose of the noble countenance impresses and awes all beholders. The typical sphinx, a male or female head with an animal's body, in the Greek the strangler, signifies intelligence or force. It was a favourite form in architecture, and sometimes the face was a portrait of an existing king or queen. The Great Sphinx is said, from an inscription at Edfu, to represent one of the personifications of the god Horus. It was designed as Horem Khu, Horus on the horizon, and bore the shape of a human-headed lion to vanquish Typhon, Set, principle of evil, and turning east, awaited the resurrection of his father Osiris. As Horus was supposed to have reigned over Egypt, kings took the name Horus, or Golden Hawk. A picture of the Sphinx, by Elihu Vedder is very impressive. The great head looms skyward. The desert spreads around. The silence of eternity broods over all. A crouching figure, old and tattered, kneels before it and lays his ear to the silent lips as if to learn their hidden secrets. The land is rich in fruits and vegetables, but it has comparatively few trees and no great variety of flowers. Palms, sycamores, figs, and acacias are among the most frequent of the former. Vegetables are peas, lentils, leeks, onions, garlic, celery, cucumbers, carrots, turnips, tomatoes, eggfruit, peppers, etc. Fruits are melons, of which the flesh is often a rich golden colour, grapes, dates, almonds, figs, pomegranates, apricots, peaches, etc. The lotus, now comparatively rare, might once have been called the national, as it certainly was the favourite flower. It was used at feasts and for decorations, and its buds, blossoms, and leaves were continually reproduced in architectural designs. It was chiefly because the water lily bud opened its petals at sunrise and closed them at sunset that the ancients held it sacred to the sun. Pliny says, "It is reported that in the Euphrates, the flower of the lotus plunges into the water at night, remaining there until midnight, and to such a depth that it cannot be reached with the hand. After midnight, it begins gradually to rise, and as the sun rises above the horizon, the flower also rises above the water, expands and raises itself some distance above the element in which it grows." And it was also through this peculiarity, says another writer, that Hankerville proved that Egyptians considered the lily an emblem of the world as it rose from the waters of the deep. Other flowers include the rose, jasmine, narcissus, lily, convolvulus, violet, chrysanthemum, geranium, dahlia, basil, etc. The horse was not an early inhabitant. There were camels, elephants, and cattle of special breeds, doves and other birds, and many varieties of fish. A number of animals were tamed in Egypt, and some of them would seem to us a singular collection of pets. Lions, leopards, monkeys, gazelles, and even crocodiles, and above all, cats were household pets, as were the last two among the sacred animals. Everywhere possible, at the present day, excavation is going on. 75 centimes a day was at one time the rate for the diggers, and 50 for the children, who carried away the baskets of rubbish, the food consisting of bread, water, a few dates, cucumbers or onions, and rarely, if ever, any meat. The Nile shore, says Bayard Taylor, shows either palm groves, fields of cane or dhurra, young wheat, or patches of bare sand blown from the desert. The villages have mud walls, and the tombs of Muslim saints looking like white ovens. The Arabian and Libyan mountains sweep into the foreground. The yellow cliffs overhang and recede into a violet haze at the horizon, while the blue evening shadows lie on rose-hued mountain walls. Life in the East moves more slowly, even in modern times, than in the strenuous West. One traveller playfully remarks that one can perceive in the face, after a Nile voyage, something of the patience and resignation of the Sphinx. And another says that Egypt is the best place in the world to rest, and recommends that one go 600 or 700 miles up the Nile before the season opens and occupy a hotel alone. You will find each day at least 48 hours long, and you will think of nothing but Egyptian antiquities and Arabs, both of which are wonderfully soothing to the tired mind. Egypt may be likened to a woman with colouring and charm, who surpasses sometimes in attraction another of more beautiful and regular form. In this land of golden light, of perpetual sunshine, lived and moved the Egyptian queen. Different and yet the same as her sisters of today, now she seemed a goddess in might and beauty, and again as the meanest of her slaves, swayed by ambitions, torn by passions, swept by waves of love and hate, a woman still. Each in turn played her little part on the stage of life, and passed beyond the curtain, leaving a few, but few, traces of her existence. Passed into the land which loveth silence, the dim Amenti of the gods. End of chapter 1.
Chapter 2 of Predecessors of Cleopatra. Predecessors of Cleopatra by Leigh North. The Queen. Egyptian queens! What a picture their name seems to call up of old-time splendors, of the light of eastern skies, the soft breath of eternal summer, of the great river Nile as a beneficent deity, of monuments and palaces, gardens and waving palm trees, houses with gorgeous coloring, of princes and slaves, all mingled on the tapestry of time. In an age sometimes called the woman's era, when woman has become a subject of analytical study to herself and to man, it may be interesting to turn from the varieties of the new woman to the very old. Even on the borderland of mythology, she asserts a strange individuality and is vitalized for us in the pages of history and legend. The Western woman on the stage of life is ever a prominent figure. The Eastern has held a place in the background, giving glimpses only of her real self, always a veiled form with dark, shining eyes, merely suggestive of beauty and charm. It may be matter of surprise, therefore, to some that in most ancient lands or among the most ancient of peoples, Eastern beyond dispute, woman held an almost modern place. In this, in some respects, advanced civilization, religiously, politically, and socially, she took her share in the world's work and pleasure, and was deemed not the ignorant child or inferior of Semitic lands, but the friend, the associate, the equal of man. The queen was the companion of her royal spouse, not his mere slave and toy. From the time of the Second Dynasty, she frequently ruled as the king's guardian in youth, as regent in his absence, or as independent sovereign after his decease, or in right of heredity. The succession was continued on the maternal equally with the paternal side, and it was at times through the female and not through the male parent that the king traced his right to the throne. Among the nobility also the same custom to a degree obtained. The son of the eldest daughter was sometimes the heir. Thus we read in the time of Sneferu of his great legitimate daughter, Nefert-Kheri, and her son was high treasurer. In the hieroglyphic system after female appellations, such as queen, wife, mother, daughter, and the like, the figure of a seated woman appears usually on a modest stool. On the monuments, the queen is always treated as an official personage. She shares the king's honors, and her name, like her husband's, is enclosed in a cartouche. we know more of her public than of her private life. As a rule, to which there were exceptions, the king had but one legal wife, of high or royal birth, the daughter of the god, as the late king was called, and hence she was in many instances, in the strange Egyptian fashion, her husband's sister. One needs surely a different standard from the Christian to judge of the morals of Egypt. The marriage of a brother and sister, so abhorrent to our ideas, was frequent in the royal family. Nor does nature herself, at that period, seem to have set upon it the same mark of disapprobation that one might expect. It began in the heavens with the gods who, according to Egyptian mythology, did not dwell on earth, and why should not humanity follow their example? Osiris and Isis were both brother and sister, husband and wife. Nor could the gods any more than men get on without magic. Even the statues of the former wore amulets as a protection against evil and death, and used mystic formula to constrain each other. Isis was, above all, the mistress of magic and famous in incantations. To her royal spouse, the queen is spoken of as thy beloved sister who fills the palace with light, or thy sister who is in thine heart, who sits near thee at the feast, or thy beloved sister with whom thou dost love to speak. A love song in which the woman seems the wooer is preserved, and we give one stanza. Thou beloved one, my wish is to be with thee as thy wife, that thy arm may lie upon my arm. Will not my elder brother come tonight? Otherwise I am as one who lies in the grave, for art thou not health and light? The other ladies of the harem are also occasionally called sisters. Sutum Mut was the royal mother, Sutum Hempt, the royal wife. Under the old empire, the queen was spoken of as she who sees the gods Horus and Set, that is, possessor of both halves of the kingdom, the most pleasant, the highly praised, the friend of Horus, the beloved of Ra, who wears the two diadems. In the new empire, she was designated as the consort of the god, the mother of the god, the great consort of the king. She was eligible to all but the highest offices of the priesthood and held forth or played the sacred sistrum to the gods, sometimes dedicating herself to one deity, while her husband served another, and she deemed it the greatest honor to be called the concubine of the god. All women desired the name of Hathor, Isis, the goddess of love and fecundity, as in the Middle Ages, the name of Mary, the mother of Christ, was specially cherished. Other popular names under the old empire signified beautiful, strong, etc. Under the new, we also find beautiful and, in addition, the names of trees, somewhat in Japanese fashion, with their cherry blossom and plum blossom, as beautiful sycamore, or hardly admirable in the eyes of the Greeks or ourselves, large-headed, which some of their coiffures and head ornaments seemed to suggest. The sons and daughters of the late king were always called the children of the god. The education of both was conducted by the most learned men of the kingdom, frequently priests, and this tutor was spoken of as the nurse. The custom of entrusting the royal ladies to such severe training reminds us of the preceptors and studies of Queen Elizabeth and Lady Jane Grey. The queen held property in her own right. At one time, the revenues from the fisheries of Lake Maurice were appropriated to her, a talent a day or upwards of £700 a year. also the returns from certain cities, as, for example, the taxes on wines of the city of Anthylla were a queen's dowry for her dress, and this privilege was continued to the queens of Persia after Cambyses conquered Egypt. After death, at least from the 18th dynasty, divine honors were frequently paid to the queen, and especially was this the case of queens Ahotep and Nefertari, the ancient tresses of the race of kings who drove out and succeeded the Hyksos, the usurping rulers, and restored Egypt to its native sovereigns. The palaces were usually of brick, as the temples were of stone, adorned with gorgeously painted walls and furnished with carpets, rugs of skin, and ebony and ivory chairs and couches. The queen was attended by slaves, and some favored maid or official bore beside her a fan of ostrich plumes. She wore, in later periods, the double crown of Egypt and presided beside the king at feasts where men and women with unveiled faces, veiling being an introduction of the Persians, enjoyed themselves together. They decorated each other with flowers, which already in profusion adorned the drinking vessels, listened to music, and watched the dancing of female slaves, the feats of jugglers, etc. Monkeys were sometimes trained to act as torchbearers, and we can imagine the confusion occasionally engendered when one or another of them, bursting, so to speak, the bands of conventionality, reverted to his naturally mischievous impulses and cast his flaming torch into the midst of the festivities. Lions, leopards, dogs, and the specially sacred cats were all numbered among the pets. The cat, it is said, was created in the Ark, hence the Garden of Eden, where the comforts of home were incompletely organized, lacked that ornament of the domestic hearth. But by the Egyptians she was, above all, valued and adored. They mourned for her as for a dear and familiar friend, and woe to the man who, even by accident, compassed her destruction. She is most pleasingly set forth by one who evidently admired and appreciated her. A little lion, small and dainty sweet, for such there be, with sea-gray eyes and softly stepping feet, she prayed of me. For this, through lands Egyptian far away, she bade me pass, but in an evil hour I said her nay, and now, alas, far-traveled Nicias hath wooed and won Arsinoe, with gifts of furry creatures white and dun, from over the sea. Till the end of the 18th dynasty, there was little change in female attire. A fine linen garment, through which the limbs could be plainly seen, extended from below the breast to the ankle, sometimes supported by straps over the shoulders, and sometimes so narrow as to require not even these. Colored robes were used less frequently. To the man was left in those days, as to the male bird, the gayer plumage. The woman contented herself with the use of oils and cosmetics, blackening her brows and eyes, leaving her hair flowing, bound by a fillet, or with braided locks or a wig, and encircling arms and limbs with innumerable chains and bracelets. The queen wore a royal headdress with the asp, symbol of the sun god Ra, over her forehead, and the vulture dedicated to Maut, mother of Isis, above. The golden disc is said to be an emblem of the eternal sunshine, the entwining asp of the winding Nile, and the outspread wings of Upper and Lower Egypt extending along the river. Mrs. Stevenson mentions innumerable texts which refer to the god as hidden in the disc, whilst a winged goddess makes light with her feathers, with which light and heat are always associated. The mother goddess of Thebes, Mut, in the shape of a vulture, spreads her wings and says, "I cover thy couch and give life to die back of thy neck." And the mother of the sun god, at the moment of birth, brings her own life to the back of his neck in flame. The disc amulet was put under a mummy to preserve the vital heat the winged disc, emblem of heaven, was, in primeval times, conceived as a bird, which under its embodiment as a hawk had come to dwell in the sun. In the 18th dynasty, this symbol over monuments was supposed to guard and protect, and played in Egypt the role that the winged bull of the Assyrians played on the banks of the Euphrates. A poetic fancy has thus painted the queen. Her form I know in airless chambers. Of vast old tombs it lives today. The quaint stiff lines, the rigid posing, the vivid colors, fresh and gay, of raiment striped and barred and fluted, and tasseled waist and sandaled feet, that lightly trod in air and sunshine the dust of some Egyptian street. Her face I guess at line and color, slow almond eyes with sidelong glance, and full calm lips with curving corners, just touched with sleepy scorn, perchance, and straight low brows, close bound for beauty, with beaten gold and burning gem, and the small asp upreared for striking, affront the quaint old diadem. So richly worn, so darkly splendid, looks out her face from shadow land. Some night, methinks, I scarce should wonder to see a living presence stand, just in the shaft of light thrown dimly from this old swinging lamp, to hear a voice that speaks the tongue of Ramses fall sweet and strange upon my ear. Pen, pencil, brush, and, I may add, imagination, have depicted for us the royal surroundings. The reigning queen had, like all sovereigns, her tasks to perform, reports from all parts of the kingdom to receive, the regulation of laws, the commerce, and the domestic affairs of her dominions. Luxury surrounded her. Attendants and slaves waited upon her bidding. Gold, silver, precious stones, and valuable stuffs composed her furniture, her table service, and her attire. Scribes indited at her dictation, and royal papyrus bore the impress of her signet, upon which vermilion was rubbed from a small cushion, while blue and a somewhat different stamp was used in religious matters. She dwelt among the columns, statues, and sphinxes, and always adorned with flowers and jewels, wore over her shoulders, when in the character of a priestess, the leopard skin of the sacrificer. As special honor to any subject, she would bestow upon him a chain of gold and put a ring on his finger. Her throne of ivory was sometimes said to have been so finely carved that a breath would move the foliage represented upon it. Such, in general outline, was the position of the Egyptian queen. But when we approach the individual, the difficulties in the study of personality are manifold. Frequently, hundreds of years pass and no queen's name appears. The role of dynasty after dynasty is searched in vain. In most cases, this is enhanced by many names being applied to the same individual, as they are derived from ancient Egyptian, Greek, Persian, and other sources. To this, one adds what is called the Ka name, a sort of religious addition to the original cognomen. A parallel to all of this might be found in the case of the Duke of Argyll, date 1734, who was also known as John Campbell, McCullum Moore, and Ian Roy Keane. The titular family and by or nickname signifying redheaded. A person searching the archives of Scotland 1,000 years hence might be as bewildered in such a case as the Egyptian student is now. Different authorities give dates hundreds of years apart, different names to the same person, and different spelling to the same name. Some of the queens were taken for men, and only in later and more exhaustive researches was their sex and position ascertained. Nor is this to be wondered at, when the various parts of speech applied to them are of the male gender. Yet here and there a fragment is discovered, and we learn something, at least, of many of them. The partial list extends from the earliest times to the Roman period. Late discoveries give us fragmentary remains from the first dynasty, but Mertytefs of the fourth seems the first distinct personality, and the role, virtually beginning with her, ends with the last and most celebrated Cleopatra. Two of these figures at least stand out with wonderful clearness. The great Hatshepsut of the 18th dynasty, and this same Cleopatra. And while many others we know much less, we in some cases possess their veritable jewels and ornaments, and in others their actual mummies. We are working, as it were, to restore a mutilated mosaic. Some of the pieces are altogether gone, many others broken and discolored. From here and there we gather a fragment for our task of restoration. They may vary in shape. They may vary in tint. The recompleted whole is diverse from the original, but it approximates. It gives us an idea of what the perfect design has been. And with that, for the present, we must rest content. End of Chapter 2.
Chapter 3 of Predecessors of Cleopatra. Predecessors of Cleopatra by Leigh North. Mertytefs. Year by year, the patient research of the archaeologist unearths new discoveries, confirming or contradicting those already made, and translating, as it were, into actual fact, much that had previously been considered legendary. And still, year by year, till the whole history is laid bare, the process is likely to continue. Comparatively late discoveries at Abydos have converted the mythical kings of the first dynasty into real human beings, living and dying thousands of years ago. Their burial places have been found, and Menes Ahamena is no longer a supposititious, but a real character. Weapons, furniture, faces, drinking vessels, jewelry, etc., with the names of various kings upon them, have been dug up and may now be seen at Abydos, in the University Museum in London, in that of the University of Pennsylvania, and in other places. Among these we come upon the first memorial of a queen. From out of the darkness of the centuries stretches forth a woman's arm laden with bracelets, and tells of the common humanity which unites us. It is thus described: the most important piece of gold work discovered consists of the bracelets of the Queen of Zur. The queen's arm had been broken off long ago when the tomb was originally plundered and hidden in a hole in the wall. There it had been overlooked alike by the builders of the Osiris shrine, by the Coptic destroyers, and by the Arabs employed by the French mission, until it was discovered by Professor Petrie's workmen, with the four bracelets in their original order. Each is made in a different and somewhat elaborate design, partly in gold and partly in beads of amethyst, turquoise, or lazuli. These finds also include the tomb of a young girl, Benar Ab, sweet of heart, whom some fancied to be the daughter of Ment, which contained an ivory figure dressed in flowing robes. And still another find includes some plaited locks and a fringe of curly false hair. The early Egyptian comes upon the historic stage very much decorated as to head, very décolleté as to garments. No Indian with war paint and feathers was more elaborately got up, so that his peruke hung in curled or braided locks about him, or, if of royal blood, he wore his crown or double crown. All else seemed of minor importance. We can imagine him lightly attired, treading the streets of modern London, and straying into the law courts, where he would encounter judges and barristers in their wigs of office. Doubtless he would bow and touch his head significantly, intimating that a common bond of taste united them. So important were these coiffures that one of the earliest offices of which we find record is that of superintendent of wigs and head dresses, and among the treasures of various museums are specimens of these belongings of royalty. Reproduced in almost every book on Egypt are these most ancient portrait statues of General Ra Hotep and his wife, the Princess Nefert. One authority assigns them to the third dynasty, and already the wig was in full flow. The gentleman wears a comparatively modest head covering, but the lady's was of portentous size and thickness, falling in curls on either side of her face with its artless, unaffected expression. Doubtless the fashionable world of that day thought the wig gave a presence, as the English dame said of caps, to the wearer. General Ra Hotep had married a lady of rank, of royal blood, his superior in that respect, but both were deemed important enough to have their massive statues cut, sitting in the usual ceremonial attitude, bolt upright, the knees and feet closely pressed together. A statue of dignity, culminating in a bust of beneficence. The Egyptian ideal was a studied dignity of posture. The Greeks, aiming at the grace and beauty of nature, sculpted their figures in the various attitudes of the human form, as also, in a degree, did the Romans. While we see on coins and in old manuscripts the Saxon and early Norman kings with knees and feet wide apart, and this also is the ceremonial Chinese attitude. But even with the formal prescribed position of the figure, the early Egyptian faces were evidently true to nature to an extent not the case in later times. There is an individuality about them which makes us feel that we see a truthful personification. In the old empire, the realistic school is found side by side with conventional art. In the fourth dynasty, especially, we see conventional figures and portrait heads, while in the fifth, all is more natural. To this last belongs the fine limestone statue of a scribe now in the Louvre, a slender but powerful figure, square in the shoulders, with slight legs and long, flat feet, seated in an oriental manner and writing on a parchment unrolled on his knee. The flesh tints a pale red, a false beard, bronze for the brows, eyes enameled alabaster and crystal, and a nail for the pupil. Another portrait statue of great celebrity is that of the wooden man, reproduced in a plaster cast in almost every museum. It is half life size, probably the foreman of a gang of laborers, is called Ra Emka, and was found at the Saqqara Pyramid. Its age has been said to be 6,000 years. It had originally eyes of opaque white quartz, pupils of rock crystal, bronze eyelids, and arms made separately, with a staff of office in one hand, and was once covered with linen, plastered, and painted. The Arabs called it the Shekel Belal or Belud, village chief. A mutilated statue of his wife was found beside him, only the head and trunk being entire. The face was of the common Egyptian type, with rather a peevish expression, in contrast to the husband's more urbane and amiable look. Statues of a certain Seppi and his wife, attributed to the Third Dynasty, are also in the Louvre. The outline of the physiognomy of General Ra Hotep and Ra Emka are not unlike in type. The Princess Nefert has buff flesh tints, her husband's are somewhat darker, and both have the crystal eyes which impart such a lifelike appearance. A dignified and portly pair who gaze steadily out above the head of the sightseer in the Giza Museum, this collection, first gathered at Bulak and later removed to Giza, is the youngest but the richest in portrait statues of private individuals. Most are in what is called the hieractic attitude, with the left arm close to the body, the left hand holding a roll of papyrus, the right leg advanced, the right hand raised as if grasping a staff, or perhaps as at the resurrection, holding the Book of the Dead. With Menes, the first distinct record of dynasties begins, so far as yet discovered, and mooted points remain for the student as to which reigned simultaneously and which in succession. The first two dynasties were Thinites, from Tini, Greek, this, near Abydos, in Upper Egypt, seat of the worship of Osiris, where their tombs and various remains, as above referred to, have been found. One of the most ancient is a fragment of jewelry bearing the name of Mena, who is said to have founded Memphis, to have turned aside the course of the river to build his city, to have reigned 62 years, and finally to have been killed by a hippopotamus or crocodile. Zer, or Teta, understood medicine and wrote astronomical books. Of others, it is said that one wrote the sacred books, another introduced animal worship, and another was a giant. Of this first dynasty, there seem to have been some 7 or 8 kings. As early as the second dynasty, under Benothris, a law was passed admitting women to sovereignty, and thereafter, from time to time, as guardian, regent, or independent ruler, a woman held sway. As goddess is above, so the woman below had her share of authority. The queen, by incantations, protected the king when in his priestly robe he offered sacrifices, played the sistrum, a sort of religious instrument, to drive away evil spirits, offered libations, poured perfumes, and cast flowers. She walked behind the king in processions, gave audiences with him, and governed for him, as the goddess Isis for Osiris in his absence. The worship of the bull Apis, destined to so wide a popularity, was also introduced in this dynasty. No extent or separate account of the queens, with one or two exceptions, can be found in the writers on Egypt, but here and there we come across the mention of certain names and brief stories or conflicting statements in regard to them. Several are spoken of by Maspero in his account of these earliest times. But to Mertytefs or Mertytefsi chiefly clings any sort of history which can vitalize her for us. We read of Mirasanku, daughter of Cheops and sister and wife of Khephren, of Mertytefsi, of Kuit, of Miriri Ankh Nas, and of Mary S. Ankh, of the sixth dynasty, worshipper of the gods. Another writer gives Mary Esank as the queen of Sneferu or Khafra, and Henson as Khufu's daughter says that Hatshepsut made scarabs of Menkaura and mentions a statue of Ra and Usa of the fifth dynasty. A stela in Giza, found at Abydos and of the fifth dynasty, represents the royal spouse Pepi Unknis and the chef owl seated on each side of a table of offerings. The city of This gave its name to the yet earliest known kings, but Memphis, the haven of the good, was the great metropolis in the time of Mertytefs. Queen Mertytefs is said to have been the first wife of King Seneferu the Betterer, whose mother is given by one authority as Queen Hepunimate. Mertytefs was, some say, of the third, some of the fourth dynasty. In a limestone group in the Leiden Museum, among the oldest portrait statues in the world, sit the queen, the mysterious Ka, which may be briefly described as the embodied spirit, and her secretary, a priest named Kenan. Without a secretary or scribe, no royal personage's list of attendants was complete. It was hardly the private correspondence which occupied their time, as in later days, though the habit of letter writing then existed, but so many items had to be noted down. The queen and her ka sat side by side, with black hair and buff flesh tints just alike. Seneferu, founder of the fourth dynasty, is the first king of whom we have contemporary monuments, and the fourth is sometimes called the Pyramid Dynasty. During this reign, the kingdom was prosperous, the arts flourished, and foreign conquests were made. The king left a good name and was worshipped till the Ptolemaic period. Diodorus stated that in the marriage contract the wife was to control her husband. Be that as it may, she was doubtless, as in modern times, the ruler of the household. Mertytefs was young, some say 14, and probably beautiful when she married Seneferu, whom she survived, and possessing the usual charm of widows, she again married the Cheops of Herodotus, the Khufu of Menetho, of whom a small ivory has been recently found by Professor Petrie at Abydos, the builder of the Great Pyramid. Mariette assigns the date 4234 BC and Bruges 3733 BC to this period, while Petrie gives from the time of the first dynasty to the sixth, 4,777 B.C. to 3,503 B.C. Some writers interpolate a certain Mertytef, sometimes said to be the son, sometimes the brother of Khufu. The building of a pyramid as a sepulchre was one of the chief occupations, might almost say the amusements or pleasures of a king, as the building of a house in modern times affords constant study and entertainment to the constructor, and day after day he goes to watch its progress. The thought of death had no terror for the Egyptians. To the king it was simply a new world, peopled with gods and goddesses, among whom he would take an honored place. His pyramid was the book, the autobiography, often an illustrated one, that he published, filled with accounts of his deeds and prowess, and certain to give him name and fame with posterity. The word pyramid is said to mean king's grave, and thus reveals its purpose. So, slowly, under the eyes of Queen Mertytefs, rose these gigantic and marvelous structures. What matter if the object were accomplished, that hundreds of lives were sacrificed in the ceaseless and laborious toil under a tropic sun? Herodotus said it took 100,000, Pliny 300,000, men 20 years in the building. We can imagine the queen from time to time going in state to view the progress of the work and helping it on with her suggestions. Some traditions tell that Khufu was specially tyrannical and cruel, and even stopped praying to the gods to press on his great enterprise. The rock testimony styles him brave and a conqueror. Egypt is the monumental land of the earth, as the Egyptians are the monumental people, says Bunsen. The history of Egypt goes, as it were, against the stream. The earliest monuments are between Cairo and Saout in Lower Egypt, the latest temples in Nubia, Upper Egypt. The pyramids, whose entrances point to the North Star and were perhaps 2,000 years old when Abraham was born, looked from a distance like isolated mountain peaks or faint blue triangles outlined against the sky, and the clear air made them seem nearer than they were. They occupied the whole horizon as one advanced beyond the plain of tombs. A near, says Miss Edwards, a mighty shadow, sharp and distinct, divided the sunlight where it fell, as its great original divided the sunlight in the upper air and darkened the space it covered like an eclipse, registering 60 centuries of history. In the early times, the three large pyramids were probably almost central in the embrace of the city, which stretched away westward from the Nile in a succession of gardens, squares, palaces, and monuments, girdling the lake with beautiful villages and climbing with its terraces, grottos, shrines, and marble pavilions, the very sides of the cliffs 2 leagues from the Nile. From the top of the Great Pyramid of Cheops today, one views the broad domes in the minarets of Cairo, the hills beyond, and a palm grove on the site of ancient Memphis, says Bayard Taylor. Over the rich palm trees, the blue streak of the river, and the plain beyond, you see the phantoms of 2 pyramids in the haze which still curtains the Libyan desert. Northward, beyond the parks and palaces of Shoba, the Nile stretches his 2 great arms towards the sea, dotted far into the distance with sails that flash in the sun. Many other pyramids are in sight, while higher than St. Peter's, Rome, St. Paul's, London, or the Capitol at Washington, the greatest of them, this enormous structure of past ages, still dominates the plain. A modern poet has said of them, amid the deserts of a mystic land, like sibyls waiting for a doom far seen, apart in awful solitude they stand, with thoughts unending, caravan between. Even then, it was probably a magnificent city in which Queen Mertytefs dwelt. Colossal gateways with a disk and extended wings above, pillars on which lights burned at night, avenues of sphinxes, palaces along the river bank, columns with carved capitals, and the lotus in bud and bloom, as well as other plants, and gorgeously painted shafts, temples of red sandstone, with forests of pillars, lakes surrounded with trees and flowering shrubs, oranges, scarlet pomegranates, olives, figs, vines, and everywhere crowds of freemen and troops of slaves. The Sphinx, previously sculptured, doubtless underwent some work of renovation at this time, and is said by certain authorities to bear the features of Khephren, aggrandized, by others that it was in the image of the god Harmachis. The Arabs named it Abuthul, father of terrors. Its present state called forth from an illiterate voyager of modern times the caustic remark, "They keep it in shocking repair." Maspero believed the Sphinx belonged to the period of the Horseshoe, followers of Horus, chiefs of the clans gathered into 1 kingdom under Manes. The Book of the Dead, which laid down rules, as we may say, both for the dead and the living, belonged to the 4th dynasty, and the fragments of it which have descended to us are the source of much of our information of this ancient land and people. Besides the serious business of pyramid building, the kings and queens had their amusements of other sorts. The harp and flute were known in the fourth dynasty, and music, singing, and dancing no doubt date from the Garden of Eden. Dwarfs were favorite pets, and a story is told of a frolic of King Senefrerus, who, for diversion, kept a boatman with girls whose airy costumes consisted of network. Perchance he may not have been so sober-minded a person as his successor in the queen's affections. Khufu built the Great Pyramid and perhaps rebuilt the Temple of Isis near the Sphinx, also a temple at Dendera, added to or restored later, first by Thutmose IV and afterwards by some of the Ptolemies. Mertytefs, or Khufu's sons and daughters, are spoken of by Rawlinson, and a daughter, Hence or Henson, was buried under a small pyramid near her father. There is a tradition that he sold his daughter for money to carry on the building of his pyramid, while she, sharing in the profits, built one for herself. The king consecrated gold and copper statues to Isis in honor of his daughter. Other stories tell of treasures buried in the pyramid.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.